Greetings. This is part 8, reviewing an Islamic poem titled, O Christ Worshippers. The author, Ibn Qayyim, lived from 1292 to 1350. We're approaching the end and have yet to hear anything valid against Christianity.
O cross worshippers, for what reason is this exalted, and blame is cast upon those who reject it? Is it not logical to break and burn it, along with the one who innovated it?
Don't overlook this has changed from Christ worshipper to cross worshipper. The misinformation now comes fast and furious from this confused Muslim poet. Let's continue point by point to address the inaccurate Islamic thinking, so-called, by this historic Islamic figure.
O cross worshippers!
Bless his heart, no Christian worships the cross any more than Islam worships Mecca, the Kaaba, the Quran, or Muhammad himself. Defending Muhammad above Almighty God is worship by any functional definition of the term. And Muslims exhibit far more worship and willingness to die or kill for their idols and their idolatry.
For what reason is this exalted, and blame who reject it? Is it not logical to break and burn it, along with the one who innovated it?
By now, I have used the following phrase several times as I addressed the ill-founded questions in this poem. Plan, command, and obedience. The plan of God was for the Messiah to die. Revelation 13:8. And all that dwell upon the earth shall worship him, meaning the beast, whose names are not written in the book of life, of the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. God revealed this plan through the prophets. Daniel 9:26, and after 62 weeks shall Messiah be cut off, meaning killed, but not for himself. Isaiah 53:8, by oppression and judgment he was taken away, and as for his generation, who considered that he was cut off out of the land of the living for the transgression of my people to whom the stroke was due. God revealed how Messiah would die in the message of the prophets. Psalm 22:16, for dogs have compassed me, the assembly of the wicked have enclosed me, they pierced my hands and my feet. God revealed that Messiah would be obedient to the plan of God. Isaiah 55, the Lord God has opened my ear, and I was not disobedient, nor did I turn back. Matthew 26:39, going a little farther, he fell face down and prayed, my Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me, yet not as I will, but as you will. God revealed by Moses an example of Messiah healing by being crucified. Numbers 21:8. Then the Lord said to Moses, make a fiery serpent and set it on a standard. And it shall come about that everyone who is bitten, when he looks at it, meaning the standard, the snake on the standard, he will live. Set it on a standard means to put it up on a pole where people may see it. John 3:14, just as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. Prophet Jesus, the Son of God, confirmed he would be lifted up, which is just like the serpent. John 8:28, so Jesus said, when you have lifted up the Son of Man, then you will know that I am he, and that I do nothing on my own, but speak exactly what the Father has taught me. Deuteronomy 18:18, I will raise up for them a prophet like you from among their brothers, and I will put my words in his mouth, and he shall speak to them all that I command him. and that I do nothing on my own, but speak exactly what the Father has taught me. And I will put my words in his mouth, and he shall speak to them all that I command him." Jesus is, without doubt, the prophet of Deuteronomy 18. John 12:32, "And I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all men to myself." He, meaning Jesus, said this to signify the kind of death he was going to die. This speaks of his death. Do not imagine this speaks of Allah whisking Jesus away. Jesus also says he does this to draw men to himself, not to Allah. Philippians 2:8, "And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross." Jesus chose to be obedient to death in submission to the plan of Yahweh God. True submission to God requires self-sacrifice to bring life to others. This Islam of Muhammad and the poet who wrote O Christ Worshipper believe submission means willingness to die, murdering other people. I'm sorry if you find that offensive, my Muslim brother. If I am wrong, prove me wrong. Show documented examples of Muslims shouting Allahu Akbar as they risk their lives to save non-Muslims. Back to the poem. Prophet Jesus taught that the prophets revealed his suffering. Luke 24:25, "Then Jesus said to them, O foolish ones, how slow are your hearts to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Was it not necessary for the Christ to suffer these things and then to enter his glory? And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he, Jesus, explained to them what was written in all the scriptures about himself." Clearly, the suffering and death of Messiah was foretold in the scriptures. Clearly, the death of Messiah, even by crucifixion, was a central part of the message of the prophets. 1 Corinthians 15:3, "For what I received, I passed on to you as of first importance, that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures." The Apostle Paul taught what Jesus taught, and Paul taught what the Comforter, the Holy Spirit, revealed, things that men could not bear to receive. The cross was the intended symbol of this suffering. Matthew 10:38, "And anyone who does not take up his cross and follow me is not worthy of me." The poet does not have a clue that the cross was mentioned by Jesus many times. This took place long before the actual crucifixion and before the final days with the disciples. Matthew 16:24, "Then Jesus told his disciples, if anyone would come after me, he must deny himself and take up his cross and follow me." I had never really associated this before, that Jesus here references the cross. In a context where Jesus has not yet fully revealed he would die on the cross. I believe this was before Jesus had begun to clearly speak of Jerusalem, his death on the cross, and resurrection. He must deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. Usage of the description his cross implies we each have an individual cross or burden to face. Will we, as Christians, face it as Jesus did? Not as I will, Father, but as you will.
For what reason is this exalted?
The cross is not exalted in a conceptual usage of the definition of that word, other than placed physically high to be clearly seen. The cross is a symbol of the sacrifice that Jesus volunteered for in order to accomplish the plan of God. And blame is cast upon those who reject it. We must first define what reject the cross means, either to Christians or to this confused poet. Muhammad rejects, with utter baseless denial, that Jesus was ever on the cross. Given that, Muhammad is to blame for the billions of souls damned by his false teaching. What else does reject the cross mean? And does that merit blame? As a metaphor, to reject the cross may mean one rejects the gift that the sacrifice on the cross provides. But a Christian does not, or at least should not, blame, as with anger, those who damn themselves by their choice to reject salvation. John 3:18, whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe is already condemned, because he has not believed in the name of God's one and only Son. He is condemned because he rejects the reality of the Son of God coming in the flesh. And this is the verdict, or the condemnation. The light has come into the world, but men loved darkness more than light, because their deeds were evil. Everyone who does evil hates the light, and does not come into the light for fear that his deeds will be exposed. I invite you, dear Muslim, to come to the light, to come to the Son of God who has brought the light of God into the world. But whoever practices the truth comes into the light so that it may be clearly seen that what he has done has been accomplished in God. If you love the truth, I invite you to learn of the one who said he was the truth. John 14:6, Jesus answered, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me.
Is it not logical to break and burn it along with the one who innovated it?
Actually, it is not logical to break and burn it. And it is not logical for several reasons. Allow me to give you an example, my Muslim brother. Would it be logical to burn and destroy surgical instruments because they can cause pain? I would hope you can understand that the process of surgery, which results in healing, can cause pain. But the instruments that work the solution are not hated for the temporary or intermediate pain. The cross is the instrument by which God has implemented his plan for salvation. We do not hate it or burn it or forget it because of many reasons. It would be a severe form of immaturity to blame the cross or hate it for hurting the Messiah. Plan, command, and obedience. It would also be complete ignorance that the cross was the victory that God planned. Colossians 2:15, and having disarmed the rulers and authorities, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them by the cross. 1 Corinthians 2:6, among the mature, however, we speak a message of wisdom, but not the wisdom of this age or of the rulers of this age, who are coming to nothing. No, we speak of the mysterious and hidden wisdom of God, which he destined for our glory before time began. None of the rulers of this age understood it, for if they had, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. I want you to know, my Muslim brother, I understand the appeal and lure of Islam. By its very terminology, it appeals to a sincere and innocent heart. Your sincere heart wants to submit to the God who created you. In Arabic, they have a word they claim means the God who created you. Allah. How simple and easy to accept the title of Muslim, which means one submitted to this Allah. But you must ask, if you have been fooled by simple, appealing definitions.
Since the Lord was crucified on it and his hands were fastened to it, that is really a cursed cross to carry. So discard it. Do not kiss it.
The cross is the instrument by which God has implemented his plan for salvation. This is why Satan the defeated must deny the whole event. If Satan had his way, he would erase all knowledge and memory of the cross. In the same way, Islam is trying to erase all memory of Israel and the Jews from Israel. And one with eyes to see can understand this is the reason for Islam.
Since the Lord was crucified on it and his hands were fastened to it, that is really a cursed cross to carry, so discard it. Do not kiss it.
No, brother. As much as Satan hates the cross as a symbol of his defeat, it is a symbol of God's plan, Jesus' obedience, and salvation for all mankind.
So, it is clear that you are one of his enemies, if you extol it, because it carried the Lord of the Worlds.
I understand the attempt at logical extension, given the flawed foundation from which Islam builds. In truth, even those who nailed Christ to the cross were not his enemies. This is why Jesus, the Christ, the Messiah, the Messiah, said from the cross, Luke 23:34, then Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing. And they divided up his garments by casting lots. But there is a side issue which must only be addressed with somber and sensitive consideration. I believe much suffering may be traced back to an ill-considered declaration. Pilate knew that Jesus was a man who did not deserve to be crucified. Matthew 27:24. When Pilate saw that he was getting nowhere, but that instead an uproar was starting, he took water and washed his hands in front of the crowd. I am innocent of this man's blood, he said. It is your responsibility. All the people answered, his blood is on us and on our children. To achieve the immediate goal of quieting a perceived troublemaker and threat to peace, a position was taken which those involved could not have fully comprehended in its scope and impact. All the people answered, his blood is on us and on our children. And sadly, some in history have taken this as rationale for anti-Semitism. That upsets me to the point of profanity, because there is no excuse for the ignorance that fuels the evil of anti-Semitism. The absolute truth we must keep in our minds, this was always and forever the plan of God.
So, Christ worshiper, open your eyes. This is what the matter is all about.
Oh, dear Muslim, I weep for you. Islam is a snare and trap and web of lies that Satan has invented to damn you. There is not one single point that Islam raises for which there is not an answer from the prophets. Can you ponder, dear brother, why is it so critical, so crucial that Islam convince you the message of Muhammad is the only words you can hear and accept and trust. It is not because Muhammad's words are true. In fact, it is the opposite. By forbidding you to really learn the message of the prophets, Islam damns you in its web of lies. If the author of Islam can convince you to ignore the message of the prophets, he has damned you. O Muslim, this is what the true matter is all about. God's plan, command, and Jesus' obedience. It was God's plan for Messiah to be crucified. It was Jesus' ultimate act of submission and obedience to die on the cross as a man. Maybe, just maybe, you desire the truth enough to dare to understand God's plan that Jesus fulfilled. If you want to be truly submitted to the one true God who made you, learning the message of the prophets and the Son of God is the true path you must choose. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.